was at the Society for Neuroscience meeting, I heard the Dalai Lama say that if neuroscientists could create an intervention to give him the effects of meditation without meditating, he would be the first one to sign up.
Ultrasound might be it.
If you pardon my French, we are scared shitless of this technology.
We're just at the very beginning of unlocking this immense technological and scientific power.
As I create technology that helps you become happier, does that reduce your ability to make good decisions? How do we define good decisions?
I had a little delay. It's all good though. And I'll just be there around noonish.
That was Shinzen. He's the lab co-director, Shinzen Young. He is very special. His real name is Steve Young, so he doesn't look like what you might expect Shinzen to look like. He became Shinzen because he became ordained as a Buddhist monk in Japan in the 1970s, I believe.
Here's toilet reading, would be the Feynman lectures on physics.
But on top of that, Shinzen is also a science geek, and so he's this trifecta in this field. I've seen him cry, literally, describing mathematical theorems. So I met Shinzen in graduate school, and I really wanted to know, what can we know about brain activity that would explain to us how consciousness emerges?
Jay and I had a relationship that built over several years. So I started to teach him some of our techniques, and we started to talk about how ultrasonic neuromodulation would be relevant to these techniques. And then there was a point at which it's like, let's do ultrasound and mindfulness.
This is where I used to come meditate, because you get a bit of shade.
We can change the way the brain functions for positive effects in terms of a broad spectrum of human happiness goals.
All right.
Good to go?
Yep. How you doing?
Let's do it.
Shinzen was also the first subject for trying to combine non-invasive brain stimulation and meditation practice.
So we're gonna do day three of the protocol that we've been doing.
What we're targeting with ultrasound is quieting a brain network that is active in all of us. And when it's active, it's often responsible for some negative self-focused thought, and it causes people distress. So by targeting the posterior cingulate cortex, we seem to be disrupting the activity of that network, giving it just a little less ability to self-organize again. People will say in our studies, I still had those thoughts, but I wasn't angry about them. I was able to observe my thoughts.
Because the ultrasound is so highly focused, we have to set the target for each individual subject.
So it seems like meditation targets that specific brain area. We're trying to boost the effect of meditation by making it happen a little bit faster.
Everything is so vivid that it's a kind of nothing. That's why you just laugh. It's like very big and very small, very rich and very thin, exactly the same time.
The best smell in the world.
We've used this paradigm on advanced meditators like Shinzen. Now the question is, will it work on beginners?
I like to go in with no expectations. I love to be surprised. I was really just scared and angry a lot, and I was dealing with a lot of trauma.
We're starting to actually have a chance to treat the deep conditions that are leading to a lot of the issues that we're worried about. Depression, anxiety, all of these things that are tormenting our society.
Am I meditating or am I just...
Good question. At this point, we just want you to stay awake.
So often in our experiments, subjects receive about 5 minutes of brain stimulation.
although it's turned on and off in that time. And then they typically sit, either meditating or doing nothing. And then about 20 minutes after that, they tend to experience the biggest changes to what it feels like or to their meditation practice.
If you don't have much meditation experience and you've never felt those deeper states, and you have that for the first time, it's a discovery the first time you have that. And you realize like, oh, I didn't realize I was holding that tension. It's like releasing a muscle that you've been holding tight for your whole life.
Ultrasound is not the first wave that we've injected from outside the skull into people to try to have some beneficial effects. And if we go way back in the 40s and 50s, people delivered electroshock. That was seen as, by many, inhumane. From there, we went to all kinds of other treatments.
Chemicals are placed in the hopper of the tablet making machine, and the pills come popping out.
Drugs are easily available, but they're horribly nonspecific in their action. They affect the entire brain and the body. Right? And so there's a host of side effects that are not just emotional side effects, but also physical side effects in using these different medications. So compared to the drugs, ultrasound is targeting a very specific region that has a very specific effect on this default mode network.
Yeah, I think the RA came in and she said, it's been 5 minutes. Do you want to do a little bit more? I was like, absolutely. Yes, please. I was able to sink into equanimity very quickly. So if you have depression, if you have chronic pain, if you're suffering from addiction, mindfulness is not really something that you want to do. You don't want to sit with yourself for, you know, even 30 seconds, let alone 30 minutes. This removes the barriers to entry and makes it more rewarding up front so that you can do the work.
We hope that this technology will have huge positive benefits in terms of human happiness, reduction of suffering, elevation of fulfillment, self-understanding, positive behavior change, and ultimately a call to service is where we want this technology to culminate.
My experience in the Bay Area didn't work out quite as I had planned. The Bay Area is all about growing technology exponentially, finding a unicorn and, you know, making that a $1 billion company and then growing it from there. I realized that the culture there wasn't quite what I needed to build this in a safe, slow, scientific, and kind of boring way. I don't have anything inherently wrong with money, but I understand it's a corrupting influence, and that may set you up for creating a relatively dangerous brain stimulation system. It would not be right at this point to just create something that you sell on Amazon and tell people to use it every day. We just don't know if that's safe. And as a scientist, that's what I have to say.
I hope we know what we're doing along the way. And I hope that we engage it with mindfulness and being careful and thoughtful and not just doing things because we can.
There might be doses and locations in the brain that you could definitely have a holy cow effect, right? Whoa, give me that one again. That's not our goal to target those. Right? It's not to say people won't figure that out, but this shouldn't be a high. It should be a therapeutic tool.
This technology scares me, and the future without a radical improvement really scares me a lot more. So that's why we got to democratize enlightenment.